Well, good morning. So, yesterday we talked a lot about single objective genetic algorithms, but unfortunately, most of the real life optimization problems are multi-objective in nature. So, just for example, that TSP problem we are discussing, that can be easily considered as a multi-objective optimization problem because we may want to minimize the cost as well as the minimize the time. And most of the cases, these objective functions are contradictory in nature. So that means if you want to minimize the cost, so probably we will be traveling by train or something, so it will take more time. And if we want to minimize the time, I have to travel by plane, and the cost will increase, right? So in these situations, the classical genetic algorithms actually don't work. So initially, when these multi-objective optimization problems were tested to be solved using classical genetic algorithm, the people tried to combine the different objective functions into a single one, just like using some weighted average or something like that. But as it was discussed yesterday, that it is not always possible to combine multiple objective functions into one. Because, for example, the time, the unit for time is maybe in days or hours, and whereas the unit for cost is rupees or dollars or euro. So it will not be a wise thing to combine or to sum a value which is expressed in days with a value which is expressed in dollar, okay? So that is not meaningful. And also, when we are doing a weighted average, it is difficult to decide that which weights actually we should tackle, because many a times we don't know the relative importance of the objective functions. So, therefore, in multi-objective optimization using genetic algorithm, as we evolved over the many years of research, the people came into the conclusion that we should optimize all these objective functions simultaneously instead of combining them into a single one and then using classical GA to solve that. We have to devise a multi-objective version of the GAs so that we can optimize multiple objective functions at the same time, simultaneously. So let us start with an example. Suppose you want to purchase a car, and you may have several optimization criteria. For example, you want to minimize the cost of the car, you want to minimize the insurance premium of the car, you want to minimize the weight of the car, maybe. And also, you want to maximize the comfortability while in the car. So these are the different objective functions you want to optimize. So there will be some objective functions that you will be trying to minimize, some objective functions you will try to maximize. And you also might have several constraints. That means you want to optimize these objective functions, but at the same time, you want to satisfy some constraints, like that you want to buy a car which should have a good stereo system. So that is a constraint. So you cannot buy an arbitrary car which does not have a stereo system. So it will definitely minimize the cost, but that will be an infeasible solution. That means you don't want that kind of car which does not have a stereo system. Another constraint may be that you want a car which will have seats for at least 6 adults. So you cannot have a small car to minimize the cost, because that will not satisfy this constraint. So you need at least 6 number of seats in your car. And also you want a mileage of 20 kilometers per liter. So you cannot have a car which does not give a mileage at least 20 kilometers per liter. So these are the constraints that you have to satisfy while optimizing the above criteria. And what are your decision variables? So all the possible cars which are available in the market, that is basically your search space, right? all the possible cars which are available in the market, that is your search space. From those cars, you have to find such cars which will optimize those criteria as well as satisfy those constraints. So, purchasing a car is a multi-objective optimization problem. So, we can cite numerous examples of multi-objective optimization problem, starting from the traveling salesman problem, this one, or any real life problem which consists of or which will require to optimize more than one objective function. So all these are multi-objective optimization problems. So in many real world problems, we have to simultaneously optimize one or two or more different objectives. And as I said, that the difficulty will be there that when you have several objective functions which are contradictory in nature. That suppose if you have two objective functions, both you want to minimize, but due to the contradictory nature of the objective function, it happens that if you get a solution which will minimize the first objective function, but that solution might have a large value of the second objective function, and vice versa. So this contradictory nature, just like the TSP problem that I mentioned, that if I want to minimize the cost, the time will increase. If I want to minimize the time, the cost will increase. So it is difficult to find a single solution from the complete search space which will probably minimize both the objective functions or all the objective functions. So therefore, the main difference with a single objective optimization problem and the multi-objective optimization problem is when you are trying to compare two solutions. So in a single objective optimization problem, comparing two solutions is easy. Because if you have only one objective function and you have two solutions, suppose solution A and solution B, and you want to know which solution is better. So what you do? You just find out which solution gives you a better value of the objective function. So that solution is better. But if you have multiple objective functions, and in this scenario you are comparing two solutions A and B, now what happens? It might happen that solution A is better than solution B in both the objective functions. Then definitely solution A is better than solution B. Or solution B is better in both the objective functions than solution A. Then I can clearly say that solution B is better. But the problem will arise when solution A will be better in objective function 1 and solution B is better in objective function 2. Then how you decide that which solution is better one? So this is not only true for two objective functions, it can be two or any number of objective function. So when you are comparing two solutions, one solution will be better in some objective functions, another solution will be better in some other objective functions, then you cannot say that which solution is better than the which one. So this is the main difficulty when we are handling the multiple objective functions. So what happens, due to this reason, finding a single solution in these cases is very difficult. So in single objective optimization problems, most of the cases what happens, we have a single final solution which gives you the best value of the objective function. So from the search space, we are searching for that solution which gives you the best value of the objective function. But in multi-objective optimization problem, in the search space, this is very unlikely that you will get a single solution which will give you the best value for all the objective functions. Rather, we will be getting some set of solutions, none of which is better than the other one. So in a multi-objective search space, you are basically looking for a set of solutions, not a single solution, a set of solutions which are definitely better than the other solutions in the search space, but among themselves, none of them is better than the other one. So the output of most of the multi-objective optimization problem is a set of solutions that is in comparison with the single objective case when we are getting a single solution in most of the cases. So optimizing each criterion separately. So sometimes in earlier days, when people try to solve multi-objective optimization problem, they try to optimize one objective at a time. So that will, what happens that when you are just concentrating on, suppose, to minimize the time, and you get a solution, but unfortunately you get that this solution has a large cost. On the other hand, if you are concentrating only on minimizing the cost, you might get a solution which will have very high time, or very large time. So concentrating on one objective function at a time will most of the cases will provide will not provide good solutions. So we have to consider all the objective functions. We have to simultaneously optimize all the objective functions. That's the main motto in modern multi-objective optimization techniques. So let us formally define this multi-objective optimization problem. So what we are trying to do here, that we have to find the vector of decision variable. So what is decision variable that we discussed yesterday? That if we have a function y equal to f of x1, x2, so basically, and you are trying to maximize or minimize y, so decision variables are x1 and x2. So on what values of these variables, x1, x2, we get the maximum or minimum value of y, that is what we are trying to do. So we are, so basically, these x1, x2, etc., these are called the decision variables. So basically, we can have n number of decision variables, and we are trying to find the vector of those n number of decision variables such that it will satisfy some constraints, some inequality constraints, and some equality constraints, and we'll optimize a vector function. So this is the main difference with the single objective version. This part is same as the single objective optimization problem as well. That means you are looking for such a solution, that means a set of combination of the values of decision variables which will satisfy some constraints. And in single objective case, you optimize or you minimize or maximize a single function, single objective function. Whereas in multi-objective case, you are optimizing a set of function, k number of objective functions. So we call it as a vector function. Vector function means a set of functions. So this is the main difference of the definition of a single objective optimization problem and multi-objective optimization problem. Yes, yes. So, as there was one objective function in single objective case, we had a single fitness value for the chromosomes. Here we have multiple objective functions, so we will have multiple fitness values for a chromosome. So, each chromosome will have multiple fitness function values, right? So, we are dealing with two spaces here. One is the decision space. Decision space means all possible values of, suppose, x1 and x2. So decision space is, so this is x1 and this is x2. And suppose x1 varies from 0 to 5, x2 varies from 0 to 10, then this is my decision space, and each, so for this particular problem, what is a possible solution? So a combination of x1, x2, that is a possible solution. So a combination of x1, x2 can be plotted as a point in this space. So suppose x1 is 2 and x2 is, suppose, 4. So this is a solution, right? If you're not understanding, please tell me. So a solution, possible solution, is a particular combination of x1, x2 such that y is maximized or minimized, whatever. So each possible solution can be plotted as a point in this space. Right? Each combination of x1, x2 is a possible solution. So this is called the decision space. This is called the decision space, right? Because this is, these are the two decision variables based on which we are trying to find the minimum or maximum value of y. Now, there is also an objective space. Suppose we want to now maximize two objective functions, f1 and f2. So f1 is an objective function, which is also a function of, suppose I just write, suppose x1 minus x2 square. So f1 is suppose like this, and f2 is something like x1 square minus x2, something like that. Okay, just for example. So there are two objective functions. You can also have multiple objective functions, more than two. So we have f1 and f2. Now corresponding to this value, so this gives you, suppose, x1 star and y1 star, the solution. If we put these values, x1 star and y1 star, we will get some value f1 star and f2 star. Are you getting it? So this solution is x1 star, y1 star. If I put these values x1 star and y1 star here, I will get two values, f1 star, f2 star, where f1 star is given by x1 star minus x2 star square, and f2 star will be x2 star minus x1 square star and x2 star. So corresponding to each solution in the decision space, we'll have a corresponding solution in the objective space. Is it okay or not? Not clear? For a one pair of value, we have a one solution. One solution in the decision space and the corresponding solution in the objective space. One pair of x1, x2 values is actually my solution. So that is a solution. Suppose that pair value I am denoting is as x1 star, y1 star. So if I put these values x1 star, y1 star in these functions, objective functions, I will get two objective function values, f1 star or f2 star. That simple thing. So as we get f1 star, f2 star, so that can be denoted as a small point in the objective space. So similarly, we have another solution in the decision space, and we'll have a corresponding solution in the objective space. If you have any confusion, please. Yeah. No, this is just an example. I'm saying that there are actually two objective functions. Both are functions of x1, x2. Because we are dealing with multiple objective functions. So we have, suppose we have assumed that there are two objective functions, f1 and f2. Right? So for each pair of x1, x2 values, we can compute both f1 value and f2 value. Right? So that I have defined f1 as x1 minus x2 square and f2 as x1 square minus x2. So for each pair of x1, x2 value, we'll get a pair of f1, f2 value. Right? So in the objective space, we can plot that value, f1, f2, as a point corresponding to x1, x2 value in the decision space. Is it not clear? Is it okay? So, each solution, we have a decision space, a point in the decision space, and a corresponding point in the objective space. Right? So two spaces. Now, what I am trying to actually mean here, you see that if we take any two solutions, suppose we take two solutions, this one and this one. So these are very close in the decision space. These two solutions are very close in the decision space. That means their x1, x2 values are very similar. That's why they are close to each other in the decision space. But when we consider their corresponding objective space solution, this is not guaranteed that they will be also close in the objective space. So two solutions which are very close to each other in the decision space are not necessarily also close in the objective space. They can be far apart in the objective space. Because F1 and F2 are defined in such a way that when we give a small change in the x1, x2 values, we'll take them far apart in the objective space. And also vice versa. That means if two solutions are very close to each other in the objective space, that does not mean they are very close in the decision space. They can be far apart in the decision space. Right? So that's why we have to deal with these two spaces, and obviously the searching will be done in the decision space, because we are searching for decision variables. Anyway, we just skip these things. So let us now define the domination relationship. As I said, that the basic difference with the single objective case and multi-objective case is how we compare two solutions. So if you have a single objective function and we are comparing two solutions, we can easily compare them based on that single objective value. So suppose we have two solutions, x1, x2, suppose we have only one objective function y equal to f of x1, x2, and we are considering two solutions, solution A and solution B, which solution will be better? For which y value is better? Right? Solution A is which chromosome is better? We compare their fitness. And for the chromosome which has a higher fitness value for a maximization problem, that chromosome is better. So this is for the single objective case. But when we are dealing with multi-objective optimization problems and we are comparing two solutions A and B, as I said, that it might happen that one solution is better in one objective function and the other solution is better in the other objective function. This might be the case. So, for comparing solutions in multi-objective optimization problem, we define some domination relationship. Now, what is domination relationship? So, let A and B are two solutions for a minimization problem. The solution A is said to dominate solution B. For a minimization problem, minimization problem means we assume that all the objective functions are of minimization type. So in reality, you might have the some objective functions are of minimization type, some are of maximization type. But as we discussed yesterday, that any maximization objective can be converted into a minimization objective and vice versa. Just taking the reciprocal, subtracting from a large number, right? So ultimately, we convert all the objective function in a single type, that is either minimization or maximization, because that will help us to write the code more easily. So we assume that all the objective functions are of minimization type. In that case, I say that solution A is dominating solution B if for all the objective functions, solution A has lesser or equal value than solution B, and there must exist at least one objective function for which solution A has strictly lesser value than solution B. Let's take some examples. Suppose we have two solutions, solution A and solution B, and these are three objective functions. So we have now three objective functions. Two solutions A and B. Can you tell me that which solution dominates the other one? Why? Because for objective function 1, both have the same value. For F2, A has a better value. This is a minimization problem, we assume. For F3 also, A has a better value. So overall, solution A has, in all the objective function, it has lesser or equal value than solution B. And there is at least one objective function for which solution A has strictly lesser value than solution B. So here we have two objective functions where A is strictly lesser than solution B. So solution A dominates solution B. What about this case? B dominates A, right? Because here F1 and F2 both have the same value, but for F3, B is better. So here solution B dominates solution A. The problem will arise a case like that. So here for solution for objective function F1, both A and B have the same value. For F2, A is better. For F3, B is better. So neither A dominates B nor B dominates A. So this situation is called, in this situation we call this solution A and solution B are non-dominating with each other. These two solutions are non-dominating with each other. Okay? So when we are comparing two solutions, one of these three cases will arise, that either solution 1 dominates solution 2, or solution 2 dominates solution 1, or they are non-dominating. So these are the only three possible cases that will arise. So this case is a special case for multi-objective optimization problem, because these two cases also happens in the single objective case, that solution A is better than solution B and solution B is better than solution A. So, non-domination is clear, right? So, two solutions can be non-dominating with each other. Because you see that if you have, suppose, 50 objective functions. So when you are comparing two solutions, there must be one or two objective functions where these two solutions are better than the other one. So solution A is better than one, if at least one objective function, then these two solutions will become non-dominating. Right. So if you have large number of objective functions, most of the cases, the solutions will be non-dominating with each other. So for multi-objective case, we go up to maximum 3 or 4, not beyond that. The techniques that we'll be discussing here will work very good for 3-4 objectives maximum. But beyond that, That is actually what the many objective optimization algorithms do. They try to find out the similar objectives. That is called objective reduction technique. Okay? So the redundant objectives can be discarded like that. So let us go for another definition, which is called non-dominated set. So non-dominating, that we have already defined. Now let us say that what is non-dominated set. So among a set of solutions P, the non-dominated set of solutions P prime are those that are not dominated by any solution in the set P. So try to understand well. So we are given a set of solutions. Suppose set of 50 solutions. A population of chromosomes, right? 50 solutions. Now, out of these 50 solutions, suppose we have two or three objective functions. So if we assume that these 50 solutions is P, then P prime will be a subset of P. And P prime will contain only those solutions from P which are not dominated by any other solutions in P. Let me give you an example that will make things clear. Suppose your P, set P is given by, suppose five solutions are there. And we have two objective functions, F1 and F2. Solution A has value like, so this is okay, so we have five solutions in P and their objective function values are like this. My task is to find P prime from this. So what is P prime? It will be a subset of P and it will contain only those solutions which are not dominated by any other solution in the set. So what we do, we first look in solution A and compare this solution with the other solutions of the set. So compare A and B, what is the relationship in terms of domination? So suppose both are minimization objective, okay? Both are minimization objective. So what is the relationship? A dominates B or B dominates A or? So they are non-dominating, right? A and B are non-dominating because A is better in F1, B is better in F2. So A is not dominated by B. We compare A with C now. What is the relationship? A dominates C, but C does not dominate A, right? So I am trying to find out whether A is dominated by some solution. That is my case. I want to find whether A is dominated by some solution. A is not dominated by B. A is not dominated by C. What about D? A is not dominated by D as well. And A is also not dominated by E. Right? So A is a solution which is not dominated by any other solution in the set. So A will come in P prime. Have you got it? A is a solution in P which is not dominated by any other solution in P. So A will come in P prime. Now test for B. B is not dominated by A. What about this and this? B is not dominated by C. B is not dominated by D. And B is not dominated by E. Right? So B will also come in P prime. C. C is dominated by A. Right? Solution C is dominated by A because in both the objective function A is better than C. Minimization case. So once we have found a solution, that dominates C, I don't have to search for any other cases because we have already got at least one solution which dominates C. So C will not come in P prime, because this is dominated by at least one solution. So P prime will consist of only those solutions which are not dominated by any solution. Okay? So C is dominated by at least one solution. What about D? D is not dominated by A because they are non-dominating. D is dominated by B, right? So we can stop searching. So D will also not come in P prime because it is also dominated by at least one solution. And what about E? Non-dominating A and E. So E will be not be dominated by any solution because it has the minimum value in F2. So it cannot be dominated by any other solution. Right? So E will also come in P prime. So given P, P prime is the set of non-dominated solutions from P. Okay? Now consider that P is my complete search space. All possible solutions. For a TSP problem, all possible tools, suppose. So my goal in multi-objective optimization problem is to find the non-dominated set of the complete search space. Because this solution are the best set of solutions from the complete search space. Because they are not dominated, so there is no better solution than this set of solutions in the search space. So our goal in multi-objective optimization problem is to find the non-dominated set of solutions from the complete search space. And these set of solutions are known as Pareto-optimal solutions. These are known as Pareto-optimal solutions. So Pareto-optimal set is the non-dominated set of the entire search space, S. So when P is the complete search space, P prime is the Pareto-optimal set. And in multi-objective optimization problem, we are basically searching for the Pareto-optimal set. So any algorithm you design for multi-objective optimization problem, they try to find the Pareto-optimal set or at least try to approximate the Pareto-optimal set. Come as close as possible to the Pareto-optimal set. Yes, definitely. Yeah. So it depends on the problem. You see that if the problem is small, suppose you have only 100 solutions in the search space. So you can simply do an exhaustive kind of search. You take that 100 solutions and just run an algorithm and find the P prime from that. That will be your Pareto optimal set. But when you have, for example, in continuous problems, you have infinite search space from which you have to find out the Pareto optimal set. So that will be definitely a very hard problem. And most of the cases, you will not get the exact Pareto optimal set, but we will try to approximate the Pareto-optimal set as much as possible. So here, the concept of global optimal solutions for multi-objective case is basically the Pareto-optimal set. I want to find the global optimal means I want to find the Pareto-optimal set. Okay? So that's why the output of any multi-objective optimization algorithm is generally a set of non-dominated solutions, which is as close as possible to the Pareto-optimal set. So let us take one example. So suppose this is your search space. Okay, we have two objective functions, both are minimization objectives, and this is your complete search space. And in the search space, we assume there are total 12 solutions, x1 to x12. x1, x2 to x12. Now you consider, suppose, any two solutions, for example, x1 and x9. Can you tell me that what is the domination relationship between x1 and x9? x1 dominates x9? Okay. So, what is between x1 and x7? So they are non-dominating, right? x1, because x1 is better in terms of f1 and x7 is better in terms of f2. Both are minimization objectives. So, you see that this is the search space, and if we compare, or if you look at the solutions in this edge of the search space, is starting from x1 to x6, you see that no other solution in the search space actually dominates these solutions. So you may argue that why x7 is not Pareto optimal? Because there exists at least another solution which dominates x7. Which are the solutions which dominate x7? So there are x3 and x4, they dominate x7, right? Both x3 and x4 are dominating x7. So x7 will not come in the Pareto optimal set. But these solutions, all these solutions are not dominated by any other solution in the search space. So they might be non-dominating with some other solution, but no solution is dominating these solutions. So that is the concept. So I may be non-dominating with someone else, but nobody is dominating me. That is the case. Nobody is dominating me. So then I am Pareto optimal. Okay? So we have a set of Pareto optimal solutions, and normally in a search space, the Pareto optimal solutions will be at some edge of the search space. Just like in this case, we have Pareto optimal solution in this edge of the search space. So whether you have understood correctly, let me test you. Suppose this is my search space, and you may argue that why the search space is so irregular set. This is because of the constraints. So if you have constraints, so you get some solution here which is actually not satisfying your constraints. So we are only considering the feasible solutions. We are only considering the feasible solutions. That means the solutions which satisfy some constraints, all the constraints. And that's why, due to the presence of the constraints, your search space might have an irregular shape like that. Now let me ask you that if both F1 and F2 are of minimization objectives, where will be your Pareto optimal front? So you have already seen in the previous slide, so it will be something like that, right? So if both F1 and F2 are minimization, then your Pareto optimal front will be there. If F1 is it clear? If now F1 is suppose minimization objective and F2 is a maximization objective. I want to minimize F1 and I want to maximize F2. Where will be your Pareto optimal front? So I am trying to minimize F1 and I am trying to maximize F2. Here? That's all? Anywhere else? If you consider a solution here, okay? Is it dominated by any solution? So your search space is something like this. So these solutions will be definitely coming, right? these solutions will be definitely coming in the Pareto-optimal set if F1 is minimization and F2 is maximization. I'm talking about a solution here. Is it non-dominated? Is it dominated by any solution? For F1 minimization and F2 maximization. Can I get a better solution which is better than this solution in both the objectives? That means has a smaller value of F1 and a larger value of F2. Is there any solution? So only possibility is that if you have a solution here, then this solution definitely dominates this solution. But this is an infeasible solution, I cannot consider that. Because this is outside the search space, outside that they are not satisfying the constraints. But if you have any solution here, 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 elsewhere, there is no solution that will dominate this solution. Agree? So you see that all these solutions up to this, this solution is dominated by some solution. Because this solution, there is a solution here that will dominate this solution. So this solution cannot come in the Pareto-optimal set. But up to this, these will be also coming in the Pareto-optimal set. Like this. So it means that Pareto-optimal set is not necessarily a continuous set. Like this. It can be divided in different parts like that. Now if F1 is maximization and F2 is minimization, where will be your Pareto-optimal set? So F1 is maximization, so we are trying to maximize F1 and we are trying to minimize F2. So definitely your Pareto-optimal set will be here, right? And if both the maximization objectives, both are the maximization objectives, then it will be at the northeast. Right? So, given a search space, my job here is to find the Pareto-optimal set, or at least approximate the Pareto-optimal set. So, this is the main goal of multi-objective optimization. Any question? So if we compare single objective and multi-objective optimization, we have multiple conflicting objectives as opposed to a single one. We can have multiple optima, like the Pareto-optimal set will consider will consist of many solutions. So all of them are globally optimal solutions, mind it. Yeah. Two goals, we have to progress towards the Pareto front as much as possible. And we have to maintain a diverse set of solutions in the non-dominated front. That means there might be some algorithm which will take you to this, up to this. And there might be some algorithm which will take you to this, but it will be only considering a part of the Pareto front. Some algorithm might be finding this part, but not this part. So two goals are, we have to come as close as possible, converge to the Pareto-optimal front, and also find out the complete diversity of the front. All the solutions on the front. And many cases, these two objectives, these two goals are orthogonal, they are contradictory. Some algorithms will be able to converge, but will not be diverse enough to capture the complete front. And some algorithm will be diverse. We have enough diverse set of solutions, but will not converge to the Pareto optimal front. And dealing with two such spaces as we are discussing here, that a decision space and the objective space, and closeness or proximity in one space does not mean the solutions will be also close in the other space. And the search will be performed in the decision space. We are looking for the decision variable values. And no artificial fix-ups means we are not combining the objective functions using some weights or anything. And we are also not considering any relative importance of the objective functions. We don't assume anything that this objective is more important than this objective. Not like that. We assume that all the objectives are equally. So single objective genetic algorithm, we have already seen a lot yesterday. So I just repeat, this is my loop. So we start with an initial population, evaluate the fitness values, check the termination criterion. If we are in a loop, so loop will consist of selection for creating the mating pool, then the crossover, then the mutation, and we do some elitism kind of thing, and that will generate the next generation population. And this loop will continue until the termination criteria is met. So this is your single objective optimization. Now tell me one thing, in this loop, where we will find the difficulty while dealing with multiple objective functions? So first, let us start from the first one. Generating initial population of chromosomes. Will it be special for multi-objective case or? Because there is nothing to do with the objective functions here. We have to simply generate the chromosomes. So that will be same as multi-objective case, just like in single objective case. Next is evaluate the fitness. Definitely here it will be different because here for each chromosome we have multiple fitness values that we have to evaluate. But that's all. That is not difficult. That will definitely take more time maybe. But that is not difficult to do because for a single chromosome, we have to find suppose two or three objective function values. That's all. Third, the termination criteria, if we consider only the number of generations as termination criteria, this will be also same here. What about this? Selection? So let us consider a binary tournament selection that we are considering. Will it be difficult here? Yes. Because we have to, when we are comparing, so in binary tournament selection, what we are doing? We are picking up two chromosomes, the better one is being put in the mating pool. Here also, if we try to do that, we'll pick up two chromosomes. Now, if we are lucky, one chromosome will dominate the other one, then we can definitely put the better one, that is the chromosome which is dominating the other one can be put in the mating pool. But the problem will arise when they will be non-dominating with each other. Which chromosome is to be put in the mating pool? Right? So selection is the main difficulty in multi-objective optimization. So here, this is the actual position where a multi-objective technique will differ from the single objective technique. I'll come to that, how to do the selection. Then crossover, nothing to deal with the fitness function. We are dealing with only the chromosome, we can always do that. Mutation also. And elitism part will be also a little different because in elitism, what we were doing, we are just transferring the best chromosomes there, but here there is no concept for the best chromosome. Here we can have a set of best chromosomes, right? Non-dominated set. So elitism part will be also a little different. I will come to that. So the main thing where we have to consider the multi-objective case is in the selection. So this is where the algorithm will differ from the single objective version, right? So over the year, there are several multi-objective optimization algorithm based on genetic algorithms have been proposed. So initially, as I said, that there were non-Pareto approaches. Non-Pareto approaches means there were like that combination of the objective function into a single one. These were called the non-Pareto approaches. But later on, the Pareto-based approaches came and they became more popular. And a lot of such Pareto-based approaches are like there, that non-dominated sorting genetic algorithm. Among all these algorithms, we will be mainly discussing this NSG2. This was proposed by Professor Kolan Moydeb when he was in IIT Kanpur. And he's no more in IIT Kanpur, he has moved to US. But his lab is still there, and it has a funny name. It is called Kangal, Kanpur Genetic Algorithm Laboratory. If you just search in Google, Kangal, you will get the link for that. And you will get also many codes for GA and NSG2 as well in that. K-A-N-G-A-L, Kangal, okay? Kanpur Genetic Algorithm Laboratory. Now, NSG2, non-dominated sorting genetic algorithm, version 2, because there was a version NSGA, then NSGA2 came. So let me first discuss NSGA2, then I can mention that what is the difference between the NSGA and NSGA version 2. So in NSGA2, there are two main concepts. One is called non-dominated sorting. What is non-dominated sorting? Here, given a set of solutions, we try to rank the solutions. Rank the solutions means we do a kind of sorting among the solutions to put the better solutions at the top, then the next layer solutions, then the next layer solutions, like that. So we classify the solutions in different sets based on their non-domination status. So first, in the first set, we will have all the solutions which are non-dominated from the whole set. It will be considered as the rank one solutions. Then if we temporarily remove the rank one solutions, from the remaining solutions, we will again get a rank one solutions. Overall, they will be called as rank two solutions. I just give an example. So this way, we rank each and every solution in the whole population. So this technique is called non-dominated sorting, because we are sorting the solution based on their non-domination status. And from these, actually, this name has come, non-dominated sorting genetic algorithm. Second is, so non-dominated sorting is required for convergence. That means, as I say, that there are two goals. I want to go as close as possible to the Pareto optimal front. And the second goal is to diversify my set of solutions so that we can capture the whole Pareto optimal front. And that is taken care by a concept called crowding distance. This crowding distance concept will be used while we will be modifying our binary tournament selection method for multi-objective case. Okay, I will explain. And elitism is also there. I'll show you how to do the elitism part. So let us first discuss what is your non-dominated sorting. Let us consider there are two objective functions, F1 and F2. And we have, suppose, 100 chromosomes in your population. So we can compute the F1 value and F2 value for each and every chromosome, that is, during the fitness evaluation. F1 value and F2 value, just like this. Suppose these are the set of chromosomes in your population, and we compute the F1 value and F2 value for each and every chromosome. Now we plot these A, B, C, D, E, etc. in the objective space like this. Okay? So for example, this is a solution for which F1 value is this and F2 value is this, like that. So these are the chromosomes in a population which are plotted in the objective space. So this is my SART space. So non-dominated sorting means from this set of chromosomes, first we find out which are non-dominated set. That means, suppose this is your P, we have to find P prime. So this is your P, we have to find P prime. So tell me, where will be your P prime? So both are minimization, so this will be somewhere here. So this is your P prime. So we call these solutions at the rank 1 solutions. These are my rank 1 solutions. Next, we assume that these rank 1 solutions are not there. We just maybe temporarily removing these solutions from the set. And from the rest of the solutions, we again find what are the rank 1 solutions. That means we again find what are the non-dominated solutions from the rest of the solutions. And these will be called as rank 2 solutions. So then we remove rank 1 and rank 2 solutions, and from the rest of the solutions we again find what are the non-dominated solutions. So these are called the rank 3 solutions. So this way we continue until when all the solutions are given some rank. Until all the solutions are given some rank. This procedure is known as non-dominated sorting. So while we are doing this, because you see that during Banerjee tournament, we'll have an advantage. So we have already ranked the solutions. So what will happen if we randomly pick up two solutions? We first check their ranks. If suppose one solution is coming from rank 2, another is coming from rank 5, so obviously the rank 2 solution is better. Right? But the problem will come when we'll be dealing with two solutions from the same rank, because they are non-dominating with each other. So for that, they defined a technique called crowding distance. So suppose this is one rank of solutions, a non-dominating set of solutions. And we want to compare two solutions which are coming from the same rank. So obviously these two solutions will be non-dominating with each other. Then which solution is better? How do you tell? Which solution is better? So here you see that the goal is to capture the complete Pareto front. You remember, my goal is to capture the complete Pareto front, not only the part of the Pareto front. So they defined a technique called crowding distance. So what is crowding distance? So two end solutions, so each solution is given a distance value, which is known as crowding distance. I'll explain what it is. So first, these two solutions, that means the two end solutions, means the solution which gives you the best value for F1 and the solution which gives you the best value for F2. These two solutions are given a crowding distance infinite. That means when you will be implementing, you will be giving a very large value for these solutions. Now, crowding distance for a middle solution, for example, solution I, is defined as, we consider the solution I minus 1 and the solution I plus 1. the solution, just immediately before that solution in terms of one objective, and after that solution in terms of the other objective. So I minus 1 and I plus 1. And we assume that we draw a box with this, and the crowding distance of this solution I is defined as the area of this box. Or maybe the perimeter of this box. So how do you compute the crowding distance for solution I? So that is this plus this multiplied by 2. You may multiply by 2, but it does not matter. With every case, it will be multiplied by 2. So the crowding distance for this solution is the area of this box or perimeter of this box. So how do you know that what is the value of this? So this is F2i minus 1 minus F1i minus 1, I plus 1, sorry. Right? So this is F2i minus 1 minus F2i plus 1. And this one will be F1i plus 1 minus F1i minus 1. Okay? So we can get these values and add up to find, to assign the crowding distance for solution I. Similarly, the crowding distance for this solution will be the perimeter of this box. So for each and every solution in between these two end solutions, we compute the crowding distance. Now what does it signify? What does this crowding distance signify? So if we compare two solutions, whose crowding distance is larger? One solution has a larger crowding distance. What does it mean? Any idea? Right. So there are no other solutions nearby that solution. But a smaller crowding distance means there are other solutions nearby. Right? Now, how does it help? So which solution is more important as per you? A larger crowding distance or smaller crowding distance? Why? So you see that a solution which has a small crowding distance, it means it is situated in that part of the front, Pareto front, where there are many other solutions to cover that part of the front. But if the solution's crowding distance is large, means it is situated in a less crowded region of the Pareto front, and there are not many solutions which are covering that part of the Pareto front. So if we lose that solution, we might lose that part of the front. Okay? So a solution with larger crowding distance is better. Better means more important, because it is capturing a part of the Pareto front. This is probably the only solution which is capturing that part of the Pareto front. So we cannot afford to lose that solution. So now we can modify our binary tournament selection by incorporating this crowding distance. So what will be that modification? So normal binary tournament, again I repeat, we pick up two solutions randomly, compare them based on the fitness values and put the better one than the mating pool. That was the original binary tournament selection. Here, what we'll do, how we modify this? Here we pick up two solutions, again randomly. While we are comparing, there might be two cases, that either their ranks differ, ranks which have been given during non-dominated sorting, either their ranks differ or they are coming from the same rank. If their ranks differ, then we choose the lower rank solution. Because rank 1 is better than rank 2, rank 2 is better than rank 3, like that. If they are coming from the same rank, which solution to be chosen? the solution with the larger crowding distance. Why we are assigning infinite value, crowding distance value to the end solutions? Because these two end solutions are very important. They are capturing the two end points of the Pareto problem. So whenever we are comparing any other solution with these two end solution, the end solution is always chosen. So that's why they are given the infinite crowding distance value. But for whenever we are comparing two solutions in between, I will always choose the solution with a larger value of the crowding distance. Because this solution is more important in the sense that they are capturing a part of the Pareto front in which this might be the only solution. If we lose this solution, we will be losing that part of the Pareto front. I don't think it will be much. So basically, it will be definitely proportional to the number of solutions in the rank, in a particular rank. So you have to first sort the solutions in terms of the objective function so that you can sort in it this way. And so sorting will be taking that n log n. And during the pairwise means we have to only when suppose we are computing the crowding distance for solution I, we have to just consider the solution just before that and after that. So that is considered the constant time, right? So previous one, this one. One way is that obviously the very primitive algorithm will be an n square for each rank calculation, okay? Each non-dominant sorting order. But they have proposed some improvement which has actually improved that thing actually. So it actually you don't need n square. I think I am not sure that some log factor has come like n log n or something like that. So actually that is a task for algorithm specialist who can improve the algorithm complexity later on. You can think of your own algorithm. Your idea is that your objective is that you have to sort this like that, but you can come up with own algorithm for that. The very primitive algorithm is obviously you have to compare each pair of solutions for omega. Yeah. So now let us just quickly go to the NSJ2 flowchart. Oh. That's why I was discussing that to find one suppose we want to find P prime from P, just one. So the very primitive algorithm, you have to compare each pair of solutions, right? So it will be an n square complexity. But actually you can improve that. So you can think about that, how to improve that. But actually that initially they proposed an n square, but later on they have improved that, improved the complexity. You actually don't need n square, right? Because you see that this is only for ranking. I have not yet come up with, because that is only one population of solutions. And from that you have ranked. But you have to deal with the complete search space. No? Now I am going for the genetic algorithm. How to incorporate those ranking method and the crowding distance method in the genetic algorithm. Okay? So let us now see the complete flowchart of the NSJ2. That you will understand. Just pardon? Yes, definitely. Because you start with, suppose, an initial population. Just like in single objective GA. We rank them. Okay, so when we generate another set of solutions in the next generation, that will be again ranked. This way it will go on. Let me discuss that complete flowchart, then it will be clear. So just like in single objective case, we generate the initial population. You can generate it randomly, as we discussed. Next step is that once you have generated the initial population, you perform the non-dominated sorting and rank the solutions, rank 1, rank 2, rank 3, like that. Just that the non-dominated sorting technique we discussed. Then you perform the selection. Selection means crowded binary tournament selection. Pick up two solutions. If they are from different ranks, choose the lower rank solution. If they are coming from the same rank, choose the solution with larger crowding distance. This way, you fill up the mating pool. Okay? So this is where it is differing from the single objective case. Right? Then you do the crossover and mutation. Just like before in single objective case. Do the crossover and mutation. This is your child population. This is the parent population. This is the child population. Right? Now we have to do elitism. In case of single objective optimization, how we did the elitism? We transfer the best solution to the next generation. But here, as there is no concept of a single best solution. So elitism is performed in this way. What they did in NSGA2, they combined the parent population and the child population. This combined population is then ranked using non-dominated sorting. So, if we have p number of chromosomes, so here we have 2p number of chromosomes. But finally, the next generation, we have to again transfer p chromosomes. So which p chromosome should be transferred out of 2p? So in this particular example, all the rank 1 chromosomes will go in the next generation. All the rank 2 chromosomes will also go in the next generation. But we cannot take all the rank 3 chromosomes. Because that will now, if we consider all the rank 3 chromosomes, that will exceed P. So which of the rank 3 chromosomes should be transferred? Based on crowding distance. Because we are comparing now one rank of solutions. All the solutions from rank 3, we are comparing them. So we have to use crowding distance for comparing. So we sort these solutions based on the crowding distance from larger value to smaller value, descending order. Then from the top, we take only those solutions which compete the p number of solutions in the next generations. Right? So these solutions are transferred to the next generation. So you see that these solutions are already ranked. So we don't have to rank again. So from here, we can directly perform the selection to generate the mating pool. So we don't need to go back and again rank because they are already ranked. So we can directly perform the selection from here. And this is the main loop of the NSG2. So what will be your final solution? What will be your output of NSG2? So in single objective case, what was your output? The best chromosome of the final generation? That was your output. Here, what will be your output? Which are those near priority optimal set? So in the final generation, the rank 1 solutions will be your output. Okay? Okay, let us stop now. And